Hi, everyone. My experience with first introduce myself. I'm a senior financial data analyst at AbbVie, and my Power BI experience first started about 3 years ago, and we had a problem simply that the data exceeded Excel's capacity, and we were looking for, you know, how can we solve it? Was in a global logistics freight, you know, how can we find a tool to solve this? And we stumbled across Power BI, didn't do much research ahead of time. And once I kind of got through that learning curve, that initial period where I actually solved the problem, I started looking at this thing. I'm like, gosh, it's amazing. Not only did it just solve the problem that we had, but it became a sustainable point where I'd go back to it for other ad hoc questions and really a source of information to be the baseline for many other problems that would come forth. So, you know, I took that, I had an enthusiasm, you know, I got to tell the rest of the company about it. And you know, kind of when I was bringing it forth to them, you know, guys, look what I have, you know, I felt a little bit like the guy standing there with the two wheels. And I'm going to hit on some comments that I think earlier in the summit really hit the nail on the head. I know in Andre's opening keynote, he was talking about, he had the full path kind of laid out for you. And talking about getting sponsors and finding those early adopters. And Mark had a quote earlier too. And he said, if you have 10 people, you know, you're likely to get one or two that are just excited right off the bat. You're going to have one that, you know, wants no part of it. And then there's kind of a little bit of wiggle room in there with the remaining seven or so of them that you're really going to kind of have to kind of walk them through it. And they're going to have the time and they're not going to jump on it right away. So I also want to hit on one other with adoption. I know Laura talked about trust and credibility. I think that's essential if reports are going to be adopted. Trust and credibility has to be a baseline. And one other comment Sam said in the keynote discussion was, you know, inspire, build a great report. And you don't have to target everyone right away. You know, you can have an iterative approach and it will evolve with time. With that, you know, my topic is internal adoption, and I have a slightly different spin I'll put on it here. And I'm really speaking to the individuals who are internal to a company. So maybe this applies to consultants too, you know, but my target audience would be, you know, you as an individual, so not on the macro scale, kind of on the micro scale. What can you do? And I'll be sharing five myths I used to believe. When I first set out to you know, create awareness, create adoption. You know, these are five things I truly did believe. And, you know, I'd like to share the realities I've learned through that path. I hope that they can help you. I'll be looking forward to answering your questions at the, you know, once I'm through this presentation piece. And if we don't go through them all there, in the Q&A session with Michael after. So first and foremost, myth number one, awareness is adoption. Again, that's a myth. And here's what I used to think. I used to think if, you know, I present these ideas to 100 people, you know, they're going to be just excited as I was, and they're going to want to adopt it. But that's not the case. Awareness is about branding these ideas. It's about sparking interest. But adoption is much more individualized. It's much more tangible. It's physical. It's other people actually using the outputs, using the tools. And adoption's real focus should be in multiplying yourself. So there is use for both of these, but awareness is not adoption. Adoption is going to be much more individual. And when I look back and you know, I kind of felt like I was on my own at first with these tools. When I got to one person to two, you know, you have to see that as a win, because effectively you've doubled your impact. And if your goal is to go from 0 to 1,000 in a matter of a month, it might be a little discouraging. So focus on that compounding, multiplying effect. So as you get two, you might go to four, and then from four to eight. And with time, hopefully it gets even beyond your reach and it just starts taking a life of its own in the company. So awareness and adoption, different, both very valuable. And the last thing I'll say in awareness is it will help you find those advocates and those sponsors. So if you present to a large audience, you'll likely have one or two people reach out after. If they're interested, harness them. See how you guys can work together to actually grow that tangible piece. So I'll go to myth number two. And the one here is one I know internally we talk about, I imagine, in many companies. This is likely when we talk about good reporting, the first way we use to describe a good report is our number of users. And the myth is the most important KPI is number of users. And if we've learned anything about KPIs and reporting, you know, we need context. Is how did it compare to our plan? How did it compare to our expenses? And why this is a myth is the number of users may just measure the number of people who needed to see the information your report contained, not necessarily if it was a good report, if it was creating actionable decisions. And before you start, know what your end goal is. And we're at an actionable summit here. And the most important thing, again, will be action and impact. So if you only have three users, but they took what you built and they made decisions off it that had value to the company, you knocked your goal out of the park. It doesn't matter how many people use it. If the right people use it for an actionable way that created impact in a positive manner for the company, focus on that, define it before you start. So myth number three, transition over here. And you know, this is one I look at, you know, personally when I initially built reports. The myth is if I keep promoting how my individual report, you know, solves somebody else's problems, I'll eventually win them over. And almost out of, you know, out of innocence here, sometimes I'd be so excited about showing my report that I'd be walking them through my navigational path. And I didn't create a space for them to speak up. It was almost intimidating. It's a new tool. It's a new approach to solving their problem. And what I've learned is, you know, settle down my own expectations into the conversation a little bit softer to say, look, you know, is this meeting your problem? Is this what you're looking for? Or do you have any feedback for me? And if you kind of set the stage for them to speak up, and if they come in and help shape that output, they're going to be very vested in the output when you get there. And setting that early, and if you're really excited about it, just calm down the expectations and just getting their feedback early, getting their buy-in. If you can have them help shape it, you'll be in a good spot for it to be utilized when it gets to that end point. So I'll go to my fourth, four or five here, myth number four. And the myth is there is a perfect idea out there to solve the adoption problem. Maybe there is. And I've looked for a long time and I haven't found a perfect answer. And my philosophy at this point is, you know, there's no magic pill, but a better approach might be focus on the problem statement. What is the problem that you're looking to solve? Build harmony around that. And the difference here is instead of putting all your eggs in one basket with this one idea that you had that's supposed to change everything, you're now setting a environment where anyone can come forth with their own idea, be inspired to see it through and carry it out. So if you get harmony around the problem, you get buy-in around that, ideas can organically sprout across the organization with a various different viewpoints, and that's good. So focus on the problem. There'll be many ideas. The more you can do to encourage others' ideas, I think the better off you'll be. And last but not least, myth number five. And this is others taking credit for your ideas is bad. And what I mean here is if you have a great idea for your company and you're not sharing it because you think someone else might take the credit or get away from you, is look, if you aren't sharing your ideas, there'll be no credit to take for the idea that you're holding to yourself. And on top of that, when you share your ideas with others, they'll help refine it. They'll help make it better, more impactful. And if they can take those ideas and you know, feel like it's their own, they'll be much more inspired to carry it through. So there is a saying out there such that, you know, the most sincere form of flattery is imitation. And I think that holds here. And there's also a well-known understanding amongst entrepreneurs and founders of companies is it's not the idea that's really what makes a business successful or a business that ends up ultimately failing. It's how they execute on that idea. And if you're looking to add true value to your organization, if it's just one idea, you know, find the value in executing on that, because that is going to be more difficult than the ideas themselves. And when you share them, you'll only kind of find ways to expand it. You're thinking maybe narrow at first, you'll expand it. And if it gets away from you, hopefully you get to that compounding effect of, you know, you have now you started as one, you get two, and it kind of can multiply through the company. So these are five lessons I've learned just from my experience. And to wrap it up and to say, if you know, at a very, you know, 1,000-foot high level here, if there's a path, and maybe you're starting out as one in your company and you're looking for a way to get some traction. You know, here's kind of reflecting back, would be my advice, would be start with a mission statement. You know, what is the message that you're trying to get out there? What is that problem? Focus on, even if it's not great at first, you know, get that down, even write it down and promote awareness, and then get the ideas out there, share the ideas. And when you share those ideas, you'll likely have one or two people who reach out to you after. And those will be people who are potentially a key sponsor who can really help get the attention of higher level individuals in your company, or they might be another analyst out there that will be an advocate for it. There'll be someone who you can almost see as multiplying yourself, and they can kind of take these ideas, you share with them, and you kind of start building a base of people there. So you bring them all together, and then you go back to that mission statement and you make it even better with that group of people. And now you have a group of people promoting awareness. So you have a group of people sharing ideas, and then you have hopefully a larger group that you bring back together. You write back to that mission statement to keep harmony, keep refining it, keep deepening your understanding of the problem. And that, I would say, if there's a place to start there. It'll start small, and hopefully that compounding effect of multiplying yourself will take off. So I think we have about 8 minutes here. I want to thank everyone for their time, and I'll take any questions. And if we don't get through them here, we can finish them on the Q&A session.
Thank you, Tyler. This was very interesting, and you had a really tough topic to present. So congratulations on finding a format that was easy to follow.
Thank you.
We do have quite a few questions, and we received a lot of questions in advance, so even before the actual event. So let's try to answer a few of them, and the rest you can cover in the live Q&A in the sessions. Okay?
Great.
Good. So there's an interesting one from Robert. How do you measure impact?
Ooh, that's a good one. So I would say, first and foremost, before you start building a report, define that goal before the report starts, so that you know if you actually accomplished it or not before you get to that solution. You should have that before you start. So impact should be, I am doing this because I want to accomplish this, before you even open Power BI, before you start using Zebra BI. The impact should be defined before the action even begins. So I would say, build harmony around what that impact is supposed to be, collaborate with your colleagues, figure out what their viewpoint is, get their perspective, and then figure out if the solution actually met that objective. So it starts at the beginning, and the only way you can measure it is if you started there. What's the goal? And then once you have an end result, did it actually meet that goal? So I would say this one starts before, you know, I'd say it's the starting point before anything else is built on it.
That's great to hear. So you were talking a lot about internal sponsors and the importance of having them. So can you share more insights into your story? So how your story started? Who were your sponsors? And I know there's a lot of interesting background there.
Yeah, there is. It starts slow. So I would say any organizational change, and we're a large company, things don't change in a month. So first and foremost, it takes a lot of patience. It won't happen immediately, but it did start just by, I think it was almost when I first got my real traction, is when I was pitching Zebra BI and internally at our company. I was trying to actually promote awareness of how amazing this tool was. But what I was also doing kind of simultaneously was I was showcasing how powerful Power BI is and interactive visualizations. And when I was showcasing the product, I was actually showcasing a whole lot more than even Zebra BI. I was showcasing Power BI. I was showcasing an advanced way of approaching problems. And it had to get approvals, and it had to go through the approval process to, you know, get the PO approved, the funding approved. And I would say, first and foremost, that was kind of an eye-opener to me, is, you know, why haven't I been doing this a little bit longer? Why haven't I been showcasing this advanced way to do it? And then I started, I'd say the second piece is, I did, you know, you have to commit a little bit more time than maybe what your job role is. And I started helping other organizations with the problems they had. You know, I started partnering with our business technology team, getting vested into their projects, and that opened the stage to a wider range of people. So if your immediate team maybe isn't sold on it, you know, I think the advice that I have there is it's not necessarily about convincing one person. It's about finding them. And if your organization is big enough, they're out there. It's just, the challenge is finding them. And if you can find them, how do you, you know, work together to a common goal? So time, persistence, and just having your eyes open to find them when they reach out, making the time.
So if I understand correctly, you were simply being proactive. You were reaching out to other teams, asking them what's their situation like, what's the reporting, were you offering your help to them? Or can you give us a specific example, something that people can take tomorrow and, you know, just try out?
So I would say in my case and the experience I had, I was fortunate enough to find key sponsors early. And it was for names internally, Mike Malley and Greg Longfield. Well, he's someone who retired, but you know, a little bit of the BTS, a little bit of the finance space. And we met, and they were the go-to individuals that if a finance team had an issue, they'd go to them. So they had mm-hmm. the visibility of where the opportunity was. And by partnering with them, it was the right sponsor to kick in the doors to allow potential for you to kind of showcase what's out there. You know, there are better ways to approach your problems. And I'd say maybe I got a little bit lucky there. You know, kind of almost looking back, I got lucky finding those right sponsors who kind of made it possible to open doors that I wouldn't have had visibility to myself. And it took time for me to find them, too. You know, I would say right off the bat, I didn't have that. It was more of a smaller scale, smaller group. But, you know, time and persistence, if I look back and say if there's something that really made the difference, it was persistence. You know, with enough persistence and time, eventually something like that is going to come through. And when it does, you don't even know it does at the time. It's just kind of always being open and aware to it. That was my personal experience. I imagine it can go many different ways, though. So I imagine there would be other people up here with a completely different story that would apply just as much.
Mm-hmm. Thank you for sharing those stories. And the last question that we can take here. So we have two. You can pick one or the other. How did you teach the wider audience to use Power BI together with Zebra BI? So how did you spread the knowledge, not just the excitement? And the second one is, can you give some specific examples of ideas to speed up the adoption? So like activities that you were driving on a daily, weekly, monthly basis.
Okay, I'll take that first one. And that was on the question being, how do you educate their organization on how to use the tools? And if you're looking higher level sponsors or higher up in your company, I think the best way to teach them is by almost teaching them without even knowing you're teaching them, such that they had a problem, they came to you for figure out a solution for it. You built the Power BI report with Zebra BI in it. And all you're doing is you're telling them, you know, ways that you're solving their problem, but you're showing them Power BI and your Zebra BI through the whole process. And you're asking, you know, does this meet your solution? And your whole conversation isn't centered around Power BI or Zebra BI. It's centered around the problem they asked you to solve. But what you're actually doing is you're coming back and you're showcasing a demo for how to use these products, and it appeals to their interest. You're solving a problem they have, and then you're accomplishing your goal as well. So it kind of comes together in harmony where, you know, it's a win for both of you. And that's what I found to be the most effective for me. That second question, maybe we can take in the live Q&A. I know we're at time here. So okay. I want to thank everyone for their time.